What would happen if all the tat, crap and rubbish in the world was gathered together and locked away? Well, Americans would have nothing to spend their money on. But also, Room 101 would have achieved its mission. The contents of the room range from Jonathan King's disgusting music to Don King's disgusting hair and Burger King's excellent lawyers. My guest tonight is a comedian and writer who's been blessed with the flair of Henry James and the face of Sid James. It's Arthur Smith. Well, Mr. Smith, I have your official choices here. The first choice is one of the purest, simplest, and I believe one of the most moronic sports known to man.
Skiing. Mm. Isn't it bloody awful? Mm. Aren't skiing people so boring? And why bother? You know, all you need to do really for skiing is like, you could like tip a bucket of ice over your head, tear up a lot of money and fall downstairs.
Yeah. Yeah, and you wouldn't get jet lag.
Exactly.
So have you been skiing?
I have once. I went skiing. I spent the whole time virtually in this cafe at the bottom of the slope. A cafe, I hasten to add, that I initially arrived in at 45 miles an hour.
And were you like, you know, those moose heads you get on the wall? Were you in the back bar, your head?
I was like an episode of a really crappy old sitcom.
Yeah.
It was desperate. And the après ski, which really sounds like some ghastly kind of, you know, aftershave or something. It was terrible. People burbling along in high-pitched, posh voices. Mm. And I hate them. I was inadequate as well. I mean, well, I was even
surely
worse.
Surely that's ever. Normally the case.
Well, I know, but well, no, I'm, there are many instances where I'm not inadequate. Mm. Moving on. Actually, in the end, I retired from all the skiing business, all the bloody palaver equipment, and someone gave me a tyre. And I just used to go down the little nursery slopes on the tyre between Bloody Marys. And that I enjoyed.
Yeah, I think it's important also to, I mean, for anybody who goes skiing, you may think that you're chic and, you know, sophisticated and look good and rather athletic. This is what you look like.
One of the most crucial things here is to make sure you keep the exit clear for the next person. In this case, Kevin.
Have you ever been skiing?
No.
No. Will you ever go?
No.
So you don't really have much to say about skiing, really, that's of any interest. I actually did it, mate. I went to...
You've done it at the top level.
I've done it, actually. I didn't get to the top. Actually, the ski lift is quite fun, because you stand there, and then the lift comes on the air, so whoops you up into the air.
Yeah.
And then you're sitting next to Fergie, usually.
But you tell me about the chair lift. The same man, again, the chair lift, this is you.
Forward, let's go forward.
Hey! Well, what's going to happen to you?
But what I don't understand, I mean, skiing, presumably in Switzerland or wherever, it was just a way of getting about, you know, it was just a normal day-to-day thing.
Listen, mate, get in the bar. Oh dear, his leg's fallen off.
Yeah. Not very realistic, you know. I feel that skiing should go into room 101. Yeah. Okay, so we're going to set that in. Very fine start. The skiing goes into room 101. Right, your next choice is a big 60s hit, and it's Sandy Shaw's tribute to the Thunderbirds. I should just warn you that this is the Eurovision entry, and they've got the sound quite badly wrong at the beginning. Not my fault.
I wonder if one day that you say that you care. If you say you love me madly, I'd gladly be there like a puppet on a string.
Actually, to be honest, I don't particularly object to that song more than what it brings back to me, because I used to be in a band. I had to sing this song. This
can
is
we, shall we see the band?
Yeah, oh, yeah. There is a
this is the band.
That was our publicity photo.
you happily sent that out to people.
And that is me in the middle, actually, with the stripy blazer on. It doesn't look like me. It looks a bit like Colonel Gaddafi. But we were in this band, and, you know, we plugged away 3 years, three gigs a night, and this song, for some, we used to start with Puppet on a String, like, as though we were going to do a terrible song, and then we would do our own sort of punk version of, you know, I kill babies, I am God, or, you know, some more controversial.
I remember that one.
The point was that I had to, I could never work out when to come in that song. Because it goes boom, boom, nah, nah, nah. Well, not
that was uncanny.
And then I had to go ah, and then you have to hold it for a long time. And all the band would be trying to help me. They go 1, 2, 3, 4. Wonder if one day that you say that you care, but I never got it right ever.
Do you want to have a go?
Yep. Yeah. Right.
I'm going to put it on the bum too.
No, I've just
I mean, talk about coming in early. The rest of the band are in the pub, he's on the stage.
Well, that's how I'm lacking in confidence.
Yeah, evidently.
Right, okay.
Okay, ready?
I need to bring back my memory. I'm in some pub in the East End. I'm getting paid £2. Right, right, they'll stop that. Nah, nah. There you go. Right.
Ah!
Oh, no. I was nowhere near it there, no, was I?
I'm just thinking they need this studio for the Olympics in 2 years.
No,
okay,
no,
another go.
I think it was 6, not 4 maybe. Right, okay, here goes. 1, 2, 3, 4.
Ah! Hold on, what's the point in saying I think it was 6, not 4, and then counting up to 4? Okay, one more go.
All right, okay, I've really come in way too early, right. Right. Right, don't come in too early, don't, relax. 1, 2, 3, 4.
Ah! Yes! It's 6!
Oh, no!
I tell you what, if you were an umpire, test matches would be a lot shorter.
Oh, no.
I tell you what, if you were an umpire, test matches would be a lot shorter. Right.
Oh, God.
6!
I think it's 8, don't you? I think
well,
it's
well
even
no, we've never got as far as 6 right. yet.
Right, I'm going to do 8.
Or you could count 6, but slower.
No, it's going to be all right this time. Thank you for spending March with us. And now the shipping forecast.
Safe rate.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8.
If you say you love me madly, I'll gladly be there like a puppet on a string.
I could never. I wish you'd never got there. Well, we've got a single that your band did.
Yes. We made 600 of these, and 500 of them are still under my bed. Sadly, because I left them up against the radiator for a bit, they're also now in the shape of ashtrays. This is the only extant copy that still works. Kleptomania, it's rather a clever song.
Okay. Let's have a little listen to it.
You shouldn't have. Ah, it's all coming back now. All right, that's enough.
Is he the only one left?
Yeah.
Okay, I don't think we're going to put this into Room 101, I'm afraid. No, you deserve the embarrassment, mate, quite honestly. Get rid of that, but, you know, you've had a certain amount of success. You are, because of that single, in the British book of failed singles, which is a very big book. So you take that home, and I'll just move this away. To do my own bloody makeup as well. And I've only got a box of Caran d'Ache. Okay, now your next choice. The British have many perverse ways of enjoying themselves. Sadomasochism, Noel's house party. But this, I believe, is one of the most bizarre. It's my party and a pride, I want
to fight. Yeah.
It's
dinner parties. I bloody hate dinner parties. You arrive at a dinner party and immediately you have to go, that's lovely, what a lovely smell, you know. They could be boiling up some old natties or anything.
Well, they could have found out their grandfather had been dead in an upstairs room for 3 months.
And then you also, what happens is that you always drink too much because it's so awful and make a pass at the host's wife. Don't you?
Yeah. I'm a view on that one, don't
you? What I'm interested by this little layout here, is, do you reckon that wine is real?
I don't know. I'm very keen to find out.
Well, hey, you're the host of the show, Nick.
All right, you get it.
All right, we'll try it out. My guess is this is Ribena. Oh, it's stuck to the bloody table.
That is what you call a tight host.
Actually, that'd be quite good if you gave a dinner party.
There's a bloke from London's burning just coming.
It would be quite funny though, actually, if you did have a dinner party and stuck the plates and everything. That actually would liven it up a bit, wouldn't it? And the forks, and they'd be trying to rip away. So I'm sure it's lovely, I just can't seem to get at it.
No, it's my mistake, I'm sure I did something wrong.
People always have an argument. There's always someone crying in the toilet.
Oh, yeah.
As well. I mean, that's
especially when you're there. Also, couples that they don't think they're having an argument, but everybody else does, you know. The wife starts telling a story. Yeah. Could I tell it?
Yes, then what happened was that... Yeah.
No, it starts before that.
You're in Finland, right? In Finland, we know with their deep Nordic melancholic souls, if you go to a dinner party, people don't speak. The whole thing is conducted in silence at a Finnish dinner party. Mm. So you just sit, you eat, you go home, that's your lot.
Well, that's how dinner is when you haven't got guests. When people say, well, it's informal, I think it should be informal. The guests should come in and, oh, I haven't got any food in. I'm not bloody going out, I've just come in. Do you want, you go to the bloody supermarket. You've been to my house for dinner, and something that you do, which is, you know, quite idiosyncratic, is you'll turn up quite late and you'll have been to the pub and you bring several other people who are in. And it's quite good.
Yeah, I
like that.
No, so, well, I have been to a dinner party at your house, and I remember your cheese board, which you hadn't bothered to get out of its plastic wrapping.
We've still got the plastic on the sofa at home.
But another thing about dinner parties is, right, because what happens is you get there at 8, and there's been a problem in the kitchen, and you don't eat till 9:30 or 10.
What, like
time?
A bomb scare? What?
Well, there may be a...
You can't just say there's a problem in the kitchen.
All right, for example, there's been trouble crisping up your creme brulee.
Fair enough. Now we feel as if we're there, see?
Maybe someone's done a runner with the Gorgonzola.
Yeah.
Whatever. There's been some problems, so you don't eat till 10, by which time you're too drunk to eat anyway.
I find that if I arrive at 6, usually. I think we're definitely going to put dinner parties into Room 101. You've done very well. Classic dinner party here. Marcel Marceau. Steve Davis. The Queen. Margie Clark. Frank Carson. And Oliver Reed. Very good. Well done. And so dinner party to go into Room 101. Bye-bye. Next choice. Mm. The date, 1991. The place, Tokyo. The event, well, it's your biggest disappointment. Let's see it and then you can explain what it is.
So what can Mike Powell do in the fifth round? Oh, he really went for that one. That's huge! Oh my goodness, 8 meters 95. That is history in the making. Beeman's figures have disappeared off the record books forever.
Now, I know a lot of people will be thinking, obviously, you hate that because you came second or something, but presumably that's not the reason.
No, no, I'm quite sad to see that.
Was that acting?
Yeah, it was like me pretending to be upset because...
Oh, I thought you'd had a stroke.
This was my youth. That was, my youth started, as far as I was concerned, in 1968 when Bob Beamon, it was mentioned there, broke the world long jump record. Mm. And it was the most fabulous athletic moment. And it was a record that was miles better than anything that had ever happened before. And at the time, I was 14 years old. I was in the Scouts. I had my first girlfriend. Life seemed to beckon everything towards me. I thought it would last as long, just as long as that record stood, I would be a young man. Mm. So when Mike Powell broke the record, I realised I had entered tragic, lean and slippered middle age.
But I think a lot of people who know you thought you'd entered that stage quite a long time ago.
Yeah,
that.
I know.
To be honest, but it's your personal choice.
No, don't you remember the Bob Beamon jump?
Oh, of course.
It is inscribed on my heart.
Do you know the commentary?
I do.
Well, I know that you know the commentary, which is why we have the clip without the commentary on it, obviously.
I'd like to see the Bob Beamon jump one last time, and I will never look at it again. And I'll show you what the commentary was, because it was a great Ron Pickering. Oh, there he is. And on the runway now, the man they all fear, erratic but incredibly talented. And he doesn't say anything during this bit. And then he does it right. There it is. Oh, isn't it gorgeous? Oh, it's an enormous one! My goodness me, it's an enormous one! It's an enormous one! He was up in the air for an age, and they're checking the measurement now. And it 8 metres 90, it's the greatest jump by the greatest margin there has ever been.
How much, given that you were 14, do you remember that because he said, it's an enormous one? Be honest.
No, at the time I was actually quite a dedicated athlete, hard to believe. In fact, I remember once, for example, I came third in a discus competition in which there were only 2 participants.
That's fantastic. Why?
Well, it was because the games master, decided whose house was the same as the boy who was the school champion who was doing Spanish A-level and would have won. Mm. So he just said, well, he'd have won, so I'll put him first. So I came third.
Still, it obviously didn't bother you.
Did you do athletics at school?
No, of course not.
What did you do?
Working. Watching the Open University and playing my violin. I bloody did!
I have this ambition. I'd like to run the London Marathon whilst chain-smoking. I think you would like, kind of, they wouldn't know what to say, would they? Because it's always, all these lovely, healthy young people who've been training forever, and there's a bloke having a fag.
Well, unfortunately, I don't think we're going to be able to put the long jump in. It's a very personal one, I think. And you've got to say, Mike Powell, I mean, at least it wasn't bloody Carl Lewis.
Yeah, true enough.
I mean, that would have been terrible. Yeah, would have been like Felicity Kendall winning it.
She was a good long jumper.
She bloody was. A long time she was British champion.
Yeah.
So instead we have to give you something to take home because we can't send anything. So we've, to symbolise the end of your youth, we've had a bus pass done for you.
Well.
And also, and I'm very pleased with this and I know you want to keep it, it's an advert I thought you could do.
Bloody hell.
So oh, you're going to have to take those home. Oh, it's gone straight in his pocket.
No, give me bus pass. I'll put that in your big bin here at the back.
Yeah. Okay, a branch of entertainment now, and one I think sadly neglected year after year by the Royal Variety Show.
Mm-hmm.
Balloon modelling. You know, I think it's...
You'd like to pass maybe with the dog and the bowl of fruit over.
Well, that's the
thing. Oh, hold on. They're balloons!
But that's the thing. When you get a balloon model around your house, all they ever make is a dog. Or, if you're lucky, a giraffe. And I feel that, in a sense, balloon modelling should go forward. And, you know, this is the plastic arts. There's no balloon modelling in Shakespeare. Mm. You know, this is something, a modern thing. And yet we're stuck with this stupid bloody dog, and that noise is so annoying.
Yes!
Like, it's really horrible.
Yes!
Would you like one?
Yeah, thank you. I think my theory is that at children's parties, they've got a plant in the audience. They say, what would you like me to make? And they've got like some old blokes in the back going, sausage dog.
Actually, having said that, though, we've got quite a high quality one, see. I mean, the fruit is real. Why don't we stick everything down on this program? You see, the fruit is convincing, in a way. And look, another thing about...
You think that's convincing fruit? Do you want to buy my car?
Also, you can't pop these balloons. You just cannot do it. You try and pop your lemon, Mrs. Look, watch. See? Oh. When I say you can't pop them... And also, the bloke who does them, he always wangles them like that and then blows like a... blows straight up. And you can't do that.
Try and blow one here, I'll get you one.
Yeah, right, let's blow up so a couple of balloons and see what we can make. That's another thing, you know, why don't they make something useful like a Corby trouser press?
Or a cure for cancer.
Cure for cancer. Right, you do this, right, that's what you do, don't you? A bit of that. And then I bet you still can't blow it up, though.
But I can.
Nothing. Yeah, you know, children's entertainers.
Oh!
You know, I mean, but anyway, kids don't want balloon models. They want jokes about poo and willies.
If you want to be a successful children's entertainer for a group of boys, take pictures of nude ladies in.
Yeah.
That's the right thing.
Yeah.
Do you want to have a go at making something? Yeah.
Yeah, all right. I think the point is...
Not a noise, all right? Not a noise. Just make something.
Yeah, I'm going to make something, because you... But you have to, like... It's a poodle!
A fluorescent light bulb.
They do all faintly resemble funny penises, I suppose.
Nothing funny about that.
See, I've done a giraffe, it's not bad. It's a camel, look.
Oh, then it's the tube map. children's entertainers. Let's see a classic fun children's entertainer giving a little bit of advice. Not this man, by the way, the second man.
So we thought we'd ask for some expert in making a children's party really go with a swing. And I've got Vic Leach with me, alias Uncle Vic. And Vic is a professional entertainer who perhaps sees more than his fair share of
Now, the rules of mainly is that not too many sandwiches. The amount of sandwiches that are wasted at birthday parties, as is jelly lately, because that's declining in popularity. Things like these over here, jam donuts.
Donuts.
You'll definitely leave those out because you're going to have sticky carpets.
Yeah.
Yeah, sticky armchairs. Sticky everywhere.
What? What I love about that is like Frank Boffney's advice on making a party go with a swing.
No or indeed way. Generating stickiness.
Yeah. I'm afraid I'm not going to let balloon modelling go. Because I have a terrible feeling it might be both of our futures.
No, I'm doing karaoke running, that's what I'm going to do.
Well, that's a shame because...
So I've got to pull this in this bin.
Yeah, we put this together for you.
Mr. Chuckles, that's me.
It's got all you need. Booze. Bags. Picture of you with Paul Daniels. So you have to take that away. You can put it down by your other case.
All right.
We'll have a bit of a tidy up. There you go.
Oop.
Anybody in the audience want this? Hard luck.
Go on.
You want that? This man is the sad man. Hang on. They'd use that in Doctor Who. Balloon villain.
Where am I supposed to put that? All right, down there, all right.
Oh, look at the state of this place. Why bother? And that was your last item. I was particularly pleased, obviously, that skiing got in. So thank you very much to Arthur Smith. Our final clip from Room 101 is a test of your observational skills. Could this man be miming? Watch very closely.
I'll be Jack and you'll be Jill. Love me till my heart breaks.